What if Barbary lions could be brought back to life using their remaining descendants? Is that possible? In today's world, reviving extinct animals has become a billion-dollar trial and error industry, such as efforts to bring back iconic species like the woolly mammoth, thylacine, and hopefully the smilodon. However, one extinct animal still has living genetic materials that could be utilized for its comeback without cloning or burning billions. The Barbary lion. Hi, I'm Hussein, and in this video, we'll realistically discuss how to bring back the Atlas lion from extinction. So, before I get into that, what is an Atlas lion? The Atlas lion is not an African lion. Yes, it is found in Africa, but they are not related to the normal African lion because the Atlas lion is more closely related to the Asiatic lion than African lions. Genetic studies suggest that the Barbary lion and the Asian lion share a common ancestry, forming a distinct northern lineage of lions that once roamed North Africa, the Middle East, and parts of South Asia. In contrast, most sub-Saharan African lions and their diverse ecotypes belong to a separate genetic lineage. However, all modern lions are part of the same species, Panthera leo. Nevertheless, the Barbary, not a separate species but a regional subspecies. The Barbary lion, also known as the Atlas lion, North African lion, and Egyptian lion, was one of the largest and most majestic lion subspecies to have ever lived. Males could reach up to 10 feet in length and weigh between 400 to 600 pounds, making them significantly larger than most modern lions. Their defining feature was their thick dark mane, which extended over their shoulders and down their chest, even covering parts of their belly. This adaptation was likely due to the colder climates of the Atlas Mountains and surrounding forest of North Africa, where they once roamed from Morocco to Egypt. But unlike the open savannas of sub-Saharan Africa, the Barbary lion's habitat consisted of dense woodlands, rugged terrain, and mountain slopes, making them more elusive and adapted to ambush hunting. Their strong muscular build and powerful limbs allowed them to take down large prey, including the extinct Barbary aurochs, Barbary stag, Barbary boar, gazelles, and even domestic livestock when their natural prey becomes scarce. Unlike the large pride seen in African lions, the Barbary lion was believed to be more solitary or lived in small family groups, likely due to the limited resources in their mountain habitat. As apex predators, they played a crucial role in controlling herbivore population and maintaining the ecological balance of their environment. However, their numbers rapidly declined due to overhunting, habitat destruction, and the spread of human settlements. The Roman Empire once captured and used thousands of them in their gladiatorial games, significantly reducing their population. Later, colonial hunters hunted them for sport, and farmers exterminated them to protect livestock. And by the mid-20th century, they were declared extinct in the wild. Despite this, genetic studies have confirmed that some Barbary lion DNA still exists in lions held in captivity, particularly in royal collections such as the lions of the Moroccan Royal Palace. These lions are believed to be descendants of the original Barbary lions. Not purebred though, as Moroccan royals and Ethiopian royals used to gift each other lions in the past. But these spark hope that this lost predator might one day return to its former range through a process known as selective breeding. So, what is selective breeding? Selective breeding is exactly what I did when I couldn't afford a purebred German Shepherd when I was broke in my mid-teens. I took a female Africanis dog and bred her with my friend's purebred German Shepherd. I then repeated the process with the female puppies I kept and within just two generations, I ended up with dogs that closely resemble German Shepherds. This process involves choosing organisms with desirable traits to reproduce, enhancing those traits in future generations through controlled breeding. In this case, the desirable trait we are focusing on is the genetic material of the Barbary lion. Besides cloning and CRISPR gene editing, selective breeding is the cheapest and least controversial way to bring back a species without playing God, especially if they are to be reintroduced in God-fearing countries of North Africa. As the beauty of genetics is that it works like a lottery. You'll never know exactly what trait will appear. For example, would you have ever imagined that Halsey has a black father just by looking at her? Probably not. And thus the unpredictability of genetics. The same principle applies to the Barbary lion. It would take just one cub with the highest percentage of Atlas lion ancestry to resurrect the species. Now, what is the step-by-step outline of how the Barbary lions will be resurrected? The first step in bringing back the Barbary lion is genetic identification and selection, which involves analyzing the DNA of captive lions to find individuals with the highest percentage of Barbary lion ancestry. Since Barbary lions are extinct in the wild, researchers must rely on descendants found in zoos and private collections, such as the Moroccan Royal Lions, which are believed to retain much of the original Barbary lion genetic material. By using advanced genetic sequencing, scientists can identify key traits such as their distinctive mane, body structure, and adaptations to colder climates, and select the best candidate for their breeding program. Once suitable lions are identified, a captive breeding program is established, pairing these individuals in a way that enhances Barbary lion characteristics over multiple generations. This process mirrors what has been done with Przewalki horses, a species successfully brought back from near extinction using a carefully managed breeding program. As population grows, the next crucial step is habitat assessment and restoration. To ensure that the reintroduced lions have a suitable environment to thrive in, the Atlas Mountains and forests of North Africa must be evaluated for available prey, water sources, and safe territories away from human conflict. Once a suitable habitat is secured, lions undergo pre-release preparation where they are gradually exposed to hunting live prey and reducing human contact to restore their natural instinct. And finally, the final step is release and monitoring, where the lions are carefully introduced into the wild with GPS tracking and ecological studies to ensure that they adapt and contribute to the ecosystem. Regular monitoring will help address challenges such as human-wildlife conflict, competition with other predators, and ensuring a stable prey population. If successful, this process will see the return of the Barbary lion as a living, breathing part of North Africa's wildlife once again. So guys, there you have it. Tell me, what do you think in the comments? Is this a good idea or not? For me, North Africa has a unique scene of wildlife. It has a mixture of both Eurasian and African wildlife, and the Atlas lion will be the necessary addition in order to complete the North African ecology. And another lion with royal connection is the Ethiopian lion. Feel free to have a watch, and as always, stay curious, stay wild, and thank you very much for watching.